Christy Whitehurst. Some of you already know who I am and part of my story, but some of you do not. Some of you I don't know. And this is Raquel Akens, and together we are going to make some yummy food for you. And what we thought we would do is, in the beginning, we would tell you who we are and why we eat this way. And we'll each take a turn, and then we will hand out some recipes for you, and then we will start working on the recipes. And at the end, we will have a taste test, and you can try and see if you like it or if you don't. So I will start. My name is Christy Whitehurst. I'm from Jeffrey City, Wyoming, and I got into health because my husband and I were trying to have a child. And we ended up having 3 miscarriages, and we got farther and farther along. First one was at 8 weeks, the next one was at 13 weeks, the next one was at 18 weeks. And so we were getting farther along, but we weren't getting there. And at that 8-week point, the first miscarriage, the doctors just said, "Oh, just try again. We don't know what went wrong. Just try again. Keep trying." Well, I got to tell you, as a woman and the one trying, it takes a toll on your body. And it's very, very difficult. So Andy and I started looking into health. We started seeing, okay, the doctors don't have answers for us, but God does. And so, and we were okay. If God said, "You're not to have a child," that's okay. We were okay with that. But we were going to do as much as we could on our part to be able to have a child. And so we looked into health more and more and more. Each pregnancy, we got healthier and healthier and healthier. And we were not at this point once we had Hadassah. But we continued to grow. Because, you know, we continue to grow in all things, not just spiritual things. But we can do that with food and, you know, want to attain better, healthy living. Because really, our goal is to have a mind that can hear that still, small voice. We always want to be able to hear that still, small voice. And if our brains are clogged, can we hear it? No, we can't even hear the tornado, let alone the still, small voice. And so the start of our healthier living was because we wanted Hadassah. Now, after changing our diet and getting healthier and healthier and throwing out all the chemicals, because I'm an all or nothing kind of person. Now, Andy's like, "Let's just creep into it." And I'm like, "No, it's all out." So if I hear something is bad, it is gone. Like, I heard that, huh?
Oh.
So one of the issues that we ran into was I had too much estrogen in my body. And when you have too much estrogen in your body won't make progesterone. You must have progesterone to make it through the entire pregnancy. And so part of that was getting out all the chemicals in our house. You come into our house, there is not one chemical in there that you would buy. Now, I can't do anything about the walls, the floor, that kind of stuff. But chemicals you won't find in our house. But in addition to finding out that there's estrogens in chemicals, I found out there's estrogens in our foods.
Sorry.
Yes. Yes. And so the chemicals went first, and then later we started finding out about the xenoestrogens in our foods, which would be our pesticides. Our pesticides, our chemicals, and some of the food that we eat, like I heard soy. And soy is a controversial thing because there's some good and there's some bad, and they'll lump it all together and give it a label, and that's not fair because we're not speaking the same language on all soy. But anyway, I will get back to so we started working on food in our diet. And we have worked our way up into more raw. We found out that more raw food is better for you. And today, our recipes are going to be raw, except for an itty-bitty amount that will be cooked. But that's why Andy and I got healthier and started changing our diet, was to have a child. And then after we had our child, then we're like, well, I want to hear God's voice more, you know, and this is the way that we can help keep a clearer mind.
So I guess it's my turn. She said, my name is Raquel Akens.
I guess we could just kind of switch around. I started looking into health food. Actually, I could probably say that coming from Peru, a poor country where most of our food was homemade from scratch, when we moved to the U.S., I had a hard time with the American food because a lot of it was out of a box, out of a can. You know, going to a public school where the food is like, I don't know how many times they cook it over and over again, you know, because it's frozen and cooked and frozen and cooked. And I just, as a kid, I knew that there was difference in food. Not all food was the same. And on my own, at the age of 16, this was before I really committed my life to Jesus even, I decided I would become vegetarian. I stopped eating meat. And I was really the only one in my home, other than my dad. He didn't really eat. He had been a vegetarian for a long time, but he was eating a little bit of meat here and there. Welcome to our family there. I really believe it was the Lord impressing my heart as a young person. So I became vegetarian as a teenager. And later on, as I started really becoming more interested into spiritual things, I learned about that God actually had instruction in His Word about food. Mm-hmm. And what natural food was about and what He gave us in Genesis, and learned that the simpler it is, the better. The closer it is to how God gave it to us, the better. And so that's, you know, for me, knowing that I was born a very sickly child and having a very sickly background, I know that the Lord's blessed me with that information. Maybe I wouldn't have had the health that I have today if I hadn't had that information, you know, when I did. So I'm looking forward to doing some recipes with you all. And feel free to ask any questions about anything. Like Christy said, our desire is to show, you know, foods that are going to be more, not highly cooked, you know, things that you can implement and to your diet. You know, the more fresh, you know, raw foods you can eat, the best. But you also want to make it tasty, because you don't want your food not tasting good. You want your food to look beautiful and to be appetizing, and yet to not be so complicated, so your body can recognize it. Mm-hmm. So, all right. So we're going to begin with
the pizza crust, and we're going to do a gluten-free pizza crust.
And do you mind? We'll switch here. Do you mind handing?
Why don't we leave this on the table?
You want to leave it on the table?
Yeah. Okay. Let me just pass it around.
Okay.
Okay.
Sounds
so
good.
I will pass this out.
No, you probably have to keep the mic here.
Oh, keep the mic here. Okay. Now, another thing that we would like to show is that we're not always going to have electricity. And right now, I'm very attached to my my Vitamix, my Cuisinart. You know, I'm attached to these things because they make my life very easy, especially trying to eat a lot of raw food. But I also want to show some hand crank items that you can use if the power goes out, because we're having more and more power outages, and it's good to know what to do without power. And actually, Andy and I, we like to, once or twice a year, take like 2 to 3 days to a week, turn off the power, turn off the propane, and anything that I would have to pay for, I don't use in the kitchen. So I'm cooking on my wood stove. I'm cooking in a solar oven. I'm using a hand mixer. And, you know, it's a real eye-opener if you try these things. I mean, I would leave on the electricity and keep your refrigerator going, you know. Don't let your food perish. But just on purpose, don't use those things. And just see how well we can adjust to this. And you might be surprised at how it goes. So today, I normally make the pizza crust in my Cuisinart, but I'm going to show you how to make it in my hand crank. I guess I call it a hand crank Cuisinart, and I'll show it to you. This is going to go around and mix while I use my handle. And usually my 7-year-old daughter, Hadassah, loves to crank this when we do a demo.
I'll be Hadassah.
You can be Hadassah. All right, it's hooked up good. Whoops, except for that. That needs to be on better.
So is the hand crank put out by Bosch?
It is not. But Bosch makes items that have this...
yeah, that looks like a Bosch.
It is Bosch. You use the Bosch bowls and you use also their...
the Bosch base.
Yes, their little guy like this. Now, the only thing they don't have that I'm still looking for is this blade, this S blade. I haven't found an S blade for this. I would really like an S blade for this.
So where do you get the handle?
This right here? This whole base came from, I want to say, Craftsman Workshop or something like that. No, you don't contact Bosch for this. This is, if you will just Google Little Dutch Maid, you'll find it. Now you will choke when you see the price. It is very expensive. It's one of my most expensive items. It's actually more expensive than the Vitamix. But I use this a lot. I use it a lot. And I know I'm going to use it a lot in the future. And so I wanted to have this, even though it is kind of expensive. So we will start with, yes?
Dutch Maid.
Little Dutch Maid.
That's not the one that make clothes.
I have no idea.
Okay.
I have no idea.
Dutch Maid.
Oh, okay.
Just to get some clothes.
Oh, okay. All right, so this will be our gluten-free pizza crust. And there are more and more people that are gluten intolerant or people who are cutting back on their grains and not wanting to have wheat, not wanting to have those glutinous grains. Mm-hmm. And so this is a lovely pizza crust that doesn't take much time. And it's very easy. So, do you want to be Hadassah?
Yeah.
Okay. So, we are on the gluten-free pizza. It's the top of the first page. And we'll add 2 cups of brown rice flour. And 1 cup of sorghum flour. One cup of tapioca flour. And because I forgot the yeast, we're going to skip it.
Just a little bit.
It's on the edge.
Oh, never.
Do I need to move?
No, it just...
Well, they can't see.
Oh, you can't see.
Okay.
Oh, let's move it then. Well,
the handle. The crank's not handle.
It's fine.
Oh, yeah. Sorry about that.
You'd have to move the table over.
Well, if you move it. It's over on your side.
Oh, yeah. Let's put it over here. That's a good idea. Good idea, Michael. Okay. I'm going to pick this up. We're going to put it over here, and it is heavy. It is cast iron, so it's not something you take camping. Or if you do, you have your husband do it for you. Okay. Can you see it? Okay.
Okay.
All right.
So it's already stirred up.
Yes. Yes. And now we'll do 3/4 cup of salt. I mean, a teaspoon of salt.
Not ground up.
Nah, it doesn't need to be ground up. It'll be okay. When we get the milk in there, it'll dissolve. And then 2 tablespoons of Italian seasoning.
How many of you here know anyone that is gluten intolerant or
allergic to gluten. So quite a number of us here.
Mm-hmm.
It's becoming increasingly common.
Yes. Okay, 2 tablespoons. And now we'll do onion powder.
You're talking about, for instance, that thing that you're using.
Uh-huh.
When the power goes out,
Yes. Probably
you're thinking about when it goes out permanently.
Yeah.
A lot of the stuff that you're adding, you have a lot of big supplies?
Well, I will make this bread until my grain supply goes out. As for the herbs, you can easily grow those in your garden. You can do that. Garlic, onion, you can easily grow that in your garden and then whiz it up after you dehydrate it. So there is going to be an issue of your supplies, and you can figure out what you're going to do at your house. Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Okay, what did I just get? Did I do garlic?
Yeah.
No, did I do this one? Okay.
I won't hurt it.
Millet birdseed that fell on the ground start growing.
Okay, I think you did it.
Okay, there's one and two. Okay. If you will start mixing it again.
You need the cover to mix.
Yeah. And as you can see, this mixes very easily. And then we will add, let me get our measuring cup for oil. Can I have this? Mm-hmm. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, so the liquid comes next?
The liquid comes next.
We're going to put the olive oil.
So 1/4 cup olive oil. All right, and you can just start mixing.
Welcome, gentlemen.
Welcome.
Please take a seat.
Okay, you can keep mixing and put the olive oil in there. Now, normally I would make my almond milk and have it very, very hot, but that's only if you have the yeast in it. If there is no yeast in it, like we're doing today, then you can use coal. Huh?
No yeast?
No yeast.
I can try that.
Because I left it at home. Now, with this part, I do this part by eye, but a general on the almond milk is about 3 cups. But it's going to be the texture. Excuse me. Sorry, I got too close.
It's a hard task.
Oops.
It's harder now.
It's getting harder.
It'll get easier in just a minute.
Keep pouring.
Okay, right. Now we are getting the texture we want.
Yeah. That looks about right.
Yes.
Are you guys able to see okay on
the
mirror?
You able to see? Oh, very
okay,
good.
That's great. This is.
Yeah, you can see that real well too, can't you? Okay, we're good. And this is done. And all you have to do is start your oven, put it on 400, and I like to put parchment paper underneath because it doesn't stick to anything. And then you'll.
How many sticks of wood is that in your wood heater?
I don't know. You'd have to ask my husband. That's not my department. This is my department. 400 degrees. So then you use parchment paper, and I'll bring this other one out of the oven. Now, when the yeast is in it, you will it will fluff up a little more. So when you pour it, you're going to want to pour it about this much. But without the yeast, it's not so fluffy. And so this was probably about half that. But this recipe will do a nice cookie sheet full of your bread. And I'm going to put this back in the oven just to toast it a little bit so that when you make your pizza at the end, it will be nice and warm for you. But this has been made prior because we wanted it to be instant for you. But this took about 20 minutes. That was it.
So that was baked, so it can be baked again?
No, I didn't half bake it, but we're just going to toast it a little bit. So just to warm it up. And then this stores very well in the refrigerator, and so you can make it up and have it ready. I think I usually make two or three of them so that we have plenty in the refrigerator that we can have a couple pizzas, and it freezes very well too. And also in the recipe, at the very bottom, I left in how you can use carob. Is that right? To use the same exact recipe except leave out the Italian seasonings, of course. And did I leave it in there or did I not?
The last one.
Yeah.
Okay. You can add a cup of raisins and a cup of carob.
Honey.
And a cup of honey if you want to, depending on how sweet or what ingredients you use. Because, you know, we're all different as to what our bodies. I mean, we have a health message in Adventism, but the fact is we still have different bodies. And we all need to know what our bodies can take. Because just because I can eat it doesn't mean Raquel can eat it. And vice versa. And so everybody needs to figure out what they can have. Because somebody may not be able to have tapioca flour. Well, just put a different flour in there. You know, we want principles. We want health principles, and then work with it, each of us individual. That's right. So this makes a very lovely carob bread that is just, it's quite tasty. So I'll pop this in the oven, and then
the
marinara sauce will be done in this. And we'll actually have to do it up here because I don't have a plug that will go that far. Is there an extension cord? Probably not. It's okay if there's not.
Yeah,
you don't have to look for it. Okay. Okay.
It would be nice for them to see it.
Yes, it would. Okay. So we'll get our food processor next. Or actually, you know what, Raquel?
Yeah.
Let's make, so that we don't have to wait, let's make the chia pudding.
Okay.
Yes. And when you're making, we're going to go all the way to the very back.
Do we have the bowl first?
I will go get a bowl. Okay. Okay. What?
Or is something available for us?
Yes. This is more raw recipes, but we're not going to make those today.
Oh.
But you're welcome to have those. Do you have the recipes?
No. Okay.
Did anyone else not get recipes?
Oh,
okay. All right, there you go. Who did I see? Here. Here. I'll get some more. Oh, excuse me. Okay. Oh, I guess 25 wasn't enough. Okay, who else?
Christy.
Uh-huh. Okay, there you go. Oh, actually, that's the same recipe as this. This one here. Yeah, that's the back.
Okay.
Okay, anybody else?
No.
Okay.
Well, we're making this stuff, right?
Yes. We're actually going to flip to the very back page of the recipes and go to the chia pudding because it takes a few minutes to plump up. And this is an excellent alternative to pudding, regular pudding. So, yes. Would you put it at about 200 and then just put it back in? Thank you so much. I think it's one of those top things. I think it goes, it's dangerous, isn't it? Especially if you're on the front row. Okay, let me show you.
Oh, wait, yeah.
Yeah, it's one of those. I think so.
Okay, you do it because
okay.
I'm lost.
I think it's one of the. I know I'm the one that's dangerous with it. Okay, maybe I don't know how to use this one. I thought it would go like this.
There you go.
Okay, all right. So we want to start with the liquid first.
I should pretty well.
Okay. Whoop. So we're going to start with the coconut milk and the maple syrup and the vanilla. Now, when I do raw, when I cook some of my items, I don't mind using vanilla that has alcohol in it. This is a personal thing. Everybody has to choose for themselves. But when we do raw ones, I like to get the non-alcoholic one, because when it's baking, the alcohol is going to bake off. But when it's raw, it's not. So I just, personally, that's what I do. And I got to rinse this off real quick.
Has anybody done GF cooking before? If you want it warm, you can bake it for a little bit and eat it. Sometimes I just eat it cold. It's very good.
Now, I like to shake this first because it helps with the mixing. It helps so much with the mixing. As you can see, it's all liquid. And for me personally, I like the full fat. But you can choose what you want to do. All right, so let's see. Oh, yeah, can we turn on the air conditioner?
It's going to be very loud.
It might affect the sound.
Oh, okay.
It's going to be very loud.
Okay. Well, then we'll skip it. Now, you don't have to do as much maple syrup. But or you can do, like for my husband, you can do twice as much. I do 3 tablespoons. But it's still good at 2.
It's better at 6.
Or 6. And then if you will do 2 teaspoons. Can you do 2 teaspoons of vanilla, Raquel?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. And that one's a
half.
Do you
need some scissors to open the bag?
Oh, maybe.
Or maybe just try opening it.
Yeah, I'll try opening it. We'll try manhandling it first.
You have natural groceries at Chilfers?
Yes, in Casper. It's about 1.5 hours away, but we do have a natural groceries. And so far, that is the cheapest place I can find chia seeds so far.
Yeah, but all the grains too, they have it.
Oh, yes. Price. Yes, they do. Now, a lot of my stuff I get at Azure Standards, the bulk, you know, 25-pound bags. And if you are wanting, because you know when you start eating healthy, you're eating a lot of, it's kind of expensive stuff. If you can afford to do 25-pound bags or 50-pound bags, it really is a big cost saver. And, I'll pour this and then I'll keep
Together also.
Yes, you can. Find a friend. Find a friend and buy together. So I like to mix the liquid first so that there aren't clumps of maple syrup.
Now, usually the coconut milk will be clumpy.
Yes.
And that may take a whisk.
Yes, normally I use a whisk.
Because it's so warm, I think we're very fortunate.
We're good.
We have our coconut milk all mixed.
We got it covered.
Yeah. You know the benefits of chia seeds? I know some of you may not have heard of it before, but what are some of the benefits of chia seeds that have been out there?
Calcium,
high in calcium. What's that?
Omega-3s,
that's right. They have oil, chia seed oil, too, that they sell, like for vitamin D or something like that. But
they have the flavor.
It has what?
It has a good flavor.
Oh, really? I find it has no flavor, which is nice. it takes up the flavor of the coconut and everything. It's very nice also for, you know, fiber and... thank you. You can get some.
Oh, thank you so much.
Thank you very much. People that want to lose weight like to use that in their water as well. It seems to help them, you know, get their digestive system moving. So It's very good for us. You know, God made it, so it must be good for us.
Yes.
Okay, so we got the chia seeds mixed in here. And then what's the next step? We put it in the fridge?
You can put it in the fridge, or you can just set it out on the counter. And in about 20 minutes, it's going to be plumped up. We call it frog egg, frog eyes at our house. Because it's like plump. So, but the chia seeds will absorb the coconut milk, and then you've got a nice dessert. And at our house, we'll put fresh fruit on top of it, and it's quite nice. Very, very nice.
Yeah, and some people, you know, when they don't have flaxseed, they use chia seeds instead.
Because it's gelatinous.
Because it's just the same kind of principle as flaxseed. So
yes.
An egg replacer, a common egg replacer, is the flaxseed. So it's the chia seed. So, and it's very, very good for you.
All right, we'll start with, yes.
Just leave it there, or want me to put it in the fridge?
We'll leave it there.
Okay.
Okay, if you'll get this over here, then I will get our ingredients to go with that.
So we need to get a little white.
Yes, then I'll bring back a cloth. Cloth, yep. Okay.
You know, I think you could. The only thing, flaxseed is very strong.
Yeah.
It's a strong flavor, and it's not as palatable.
Here you go.
All right, you can make it half half.
Probably have to be flax meal.
Flax meal.
Yeah.
The whole flax could be done, but it's just harder to chew.
I'm afraid you might find it a little challenging to eat, though, with the flax seed.
Yeah.
The chia is going to be much tastier.
Yeah. On your salad?
Yeah, so that's a good way to get it,
yeah.
Get it in as quick.
My.
Hey, those smaller seeds do. Okay.
Would you do me a huge favor? Andy, would you go look in the cooler for the ginger? The ginger. I forgot it in the cooler. Okay. Let me get this out. Now we will go on to the marinara. Yes.
Is that how you look?
Or it goes this way. There we go. All right.
This is a powerful machine.
That's a woman's power tool.
Powerful girl running it. Very long.
Okay, so next recipe we'll be doing
the marinara sauce.
It's a topping for our pizza that we, the pizza,
yes,
crust that we just made.
Yes, and we're gonna double it. In the bold underneath the pizza crust, I wrote that you should double the pizza cheese and the marinara sauce to equal the size of the pizza. So, anyway, so we'll start with 4 cups of tomatoes. Now, does anyone know why we should have more raw than cooked? Or does anybody know how much raw you should have? Yes.
Enzymes.
Yes.
It runs up for a long time.
80% and it's 80% raw.
Yes.
75%.
We usually tell people 75% raw, just because if you take... Would you?
Another knife for.
Okay. Actually, can I talk and you cut those up? Does anybody have a pen on them or a marker? Okay, cool. I want to show you what you want to do with your plate when it comes to raw and cooked and acidic food versus alkaline food. Oh, yes. Okay, am I good? Okay. So here is our plate. What we want to do is treat it like a clock, okay? So we got 12, we got 6, we got 3, we got 9.
When it comes to raw food, and the raw food is going to come with its enzymes to digest. It's going to break down. And if your food has enzymes in them already, your body doesn't have to take enzymes from your bank to digest your food. Therefore, your body can continue functioning as it should. Now, let's think back to the Garden of Eden. Did they build a little fire and they cook their food? No. They would just pick it and eat it. And I realize we can't do that with all of our food today, but the principle is still there. Our bodies were made to run on fresh fruits and vegetables. Well, originally it wasn't the vegetables. We got that after the tree of life was taken away. But, okay, back to our plate. We want to draw a line from 12 to 3, and this is our 25%, where we will want our cooked food and we'll want our acidic food. The 75% over here needs to be your raw and your alkaline.
Does everybody understand when she says acidic what she means? Okay, she's not just talking about like lemons or anything. Harsh,
yes,
but
it is the
processed foods.
Yes,
that will turn acidic in your body.
Correct. And so you want your raw and your alkaline to be in the 75%. And another thing, have any of you heard of leaky gut or yeast infections and stuff like that? Okay, we have good bacteria in our gut. We have bad bacteria in our gut. And we have yeast. Now, those are all supposed to be there. But they have to be in balance. In balance. And when you are eating more raw food, you are keeping that in balance. And a lot of people will ask us, how do you know if you're alkaline enough? And you can use the strips, but I got to tell you, your body is designed amazingly. And so if you are too acidic, your body is going to pull the calcium from your bones and your teeth. And it's going to put it in, it's going to be in your saliva then. It's going to be in the, it's going to be in those tests that you use the strips for. So you can get false readings on those and think that you are alkaline enough, but that's because the magnesium, the sodium, the potassium, and the calcium are being pulled from your body, your muscles, your bones, to keep you in check. Otherwise, you would die. It's really more based on what you are eating. You need to be aware of what's on your plate and what you're putting in. Yes?
Chrissy, Peter Carson's, he's down in Illinois, but he does the pH thing. He told us that the urine should be checked after 4, the first urine after 4, and then you get a good reading whether you're alkaline or acidic. And the reason he said that is because he had a young man that he was eating supper with, and he told the young man he was acidic.
Uh-huh.
And he told him to go check his urine. When the young man came back, he said, I'm alkaline.
Yeah.
And Peter's like, oh, no, there's something wrong with this.
Yes.
I can look at you and tell you.
Yes. Exactly. Yeah.
So it has to be the first urine after 4 a.m.
Yes.
Right, getting ready to dump all that stuff out.
Well, and there's a mathematical equation to take the urine test and to take the saliva test and put it together to get a better idea. But we do want to be aware, and there are, isn't there like a cell test or something that's very, very accurate, but it's extremely expensive. Oh.
That's the ultimate objective.
Yes.
The cell pH.
But that's very expensive, and you and I could not afford to do that. So we need to be aware of what's on our plate. And we need to be aware of our symptoms. If we are sick, we're going to be out of balance.
That's right.
Yes.
In my own experience, the people are sick, it's not going to work that. It's not going to work 75% raw food. And it has to be a half.
A half
of the plate has to be, 50% has to be your vegetables. and that 50% has to be 75% raw and 25% steam. Because sick people like leaky gut,
yes,
or candidiasis or whatever other issues from the bowels,
uh-huh,
they will not absorb that 75% or 80% raw food.
Because they've got to heal the gut.
Yes.
You've got to get...
The way to heal is mix raw and steam.
Well, and there are certain vegetables that you do want to steam. There are some, the cruciferous family, your kale, your broccoli, your cabbage. You either need to culture it or you need to steam it. Otherwise, it's going to mess with your thyroid.
Yes.
And people don't know that. They don't really, they'll juice kale like every single day. You will end up with a messed up thyroid. It will happen.
Hypothyroid.
Yes, hypothyroid. Yes, yes.
Can you explain culture?
Oh, culture. That's where you, a lot of people will use the word ferment. I don't like to use the word ferment. The just because everybody's thinking, oh, you're brewing wine. No. You're making bacteria that is good for your gut, and
there is a difference between culturing and fermenting.
Yes.
Not everybody in the world will recognize that difference, but a fermentation produces an alcoholic byproduct, and you don't want anything to do with that.
Mm-mm.
But the culturing process produces absolutely no alcohol byproduct.
Mm-hmm.
And
but good bacteria.
It makes the good bacteria that is within the gut.
Yes. Yes. So if you culture the like sauerkraut. Does anybody eat sauerkraut? Do you make your own sauerkraut? You do. Excellent. Just before we left on Thursday, we had a culturing class, and we taught people how to make sauerkraut and yogurt and Rejuvelac and cheese from the Rejuvelac. And yes.
There's also another thing that I came across. I know that it probably won't help with, I have heard it probably won't help with leaky gut, but I can understand it will help a lot of other people.
Uh-huh.
That's, I got kefir grains, water kefir grains, and you can basically make your own vegan probiotic.
Yes.
Just using coconut water and dump that, those kefir grains in there.
Uh-huh.
Let it feed.
Kefir. Oh, I know what you're saying now. Okay, kefir. Yes.
Let it feed on sugar and some molasses.
Yes. Yes.
And 48 hours on the counter and you have probiotics.
Yes. Yes. And actually, if we would have had time, I was going to teach you how to make yogurt in 4 hours from coconut, a fresh coconut and the young coconut, thank you, and almonds and a probiotic that you put in there. And you get this wonderful yogurt that you can put on cereal. You can do all kinds of stuff with it. So,
yes, so did you?
Huh? Do you make kefir?
I do not make kefir. My knowledge only goes so far. I'm doing good to get the sauerkraut and the yogurt at this point. So I'm still on that journey of adding more in there. So the kefir, no, I'm not there yet.
You have somebody on this campground that's making kefir.
Huh?
Yeah, we have somebody on the campground.
Would that be you?
No.
Oh, okay.
It's Sandy McCrillis.
Oh. Okay. Oh, very good. Very good.
And you know that I, well, when I became an Adventist, that was 19 years ago.
I'm gonna help you.
I always heard that Ellen White said that we should not be eating anything fermented.
Uh-huh.
We should not be eating vinegar. We should not be eating this or that.
Yes.
And well, I grasped those things that I was listening. And later on in life, I came to this country.
Uh-huh.
And
would you go give me a
and I found that people use a lot of fermented food and also cultured food.
Yes.
But for me, it was just wrong. Like I heard always so many Adventists, you know. And then I said, well, then I never touched it. But I used to eat yogurt.
Uh-huh.
I stopped doing because I saw it was wrong to do it. And I just, this experience I'm telling you guys, don't do the same mistake. And also in the United States, they tell you, especially if you have your primary care, oh no, the United States doesn't have parasites. Their people are very clean without parasites.
No.
In my country, because I am from the jungle, I grew up in this principle that every 2 months or 6 months you have to have a cleanse. I grew up that way. My mother took care like that. I took care of my children like that. But when I came to this country, the doctors were telling me, no, you can't do with your kids such a thing. You have parasites. And really everyone was saying, no parasite. Oh, good thing. I don't have to be cleansing myself every 2 months or 3 months. I went 13 years of my life without cleanse.
And see, we
I was destroying myself. Even I stopped eating the probiotics or the cultured food because it's wrong for you, you know? And I stopped taking also supplements as vitamins and minerals. And I took everything away. And you know, and I was just very ill and ill and ill. And I said, what I'm doing wrong?
I'll do with one.
What is wrong? And well, and this all this process, I got so ill.
Yes.
And I got the point I could not, I barely walk, I could not talk.
Yes.
And well, my life was so sad.
Yes.
I was dying. I was diagnosed with many other things that I don't even want to name the names because I don't even know pronouncing the names of those diseases the doctors gave me. But until finally I find a doctor that tested me for parasites. And I have a big, huge, great zoo.
Yes. Most of us do. Most of us do. And realistically, we need to have a parasite cleanse at least once a year, if not every 6 months.
Oh, I'm having now every 3 months.
Yes.
I'm going to get for 1 year. And then this doctor of mine told me, Ana Maria, you really need this. And it was a very strong probiotic. I don't know if you guys heard about BSL number 3.
Well,
helped me to recover, and later on I find out on my own that really we need a culture food.
We do. And I'd like to say something about that. You know, you said that you read that we're not to have fermented food. Oh, excuse me. Fermented food. You know, when we read something, we really need to find out the principle of everything that we read. Because I'm going to show you how to make a green smoothie today. And I'm hoping there's going to be a good Adventist in the crowd that's going to say, oh, don't put your fruits and vegetables together, please. But you need to know why. Why was that stated? Why about the fermented food? And what is fermented food? When we have good bacteria, we must have good bacteria. We must. And so it's good to know the principle behind that.
I'll put the olive oil in.
95% of the people on the planet, they say, have parasites.
Yes.
And it's the 5% of the ones that just did a cleanse.
And the
ones yes.
Yeah. But now I made my own yogurt. No cow or goat.
Yes, we can make it vegan.
Will you be giving us recipes for the yogurt?
The yogurt is in the recipes, yes. It will be in tomorrow's recipe. Yes, absolutely.
I think that's good.
And so is the cheese. And so is the Rejuvelac. So.
Okay, so let's finish up on the tomato sauce.
Let's get it done, yeah.
So is this one recipe or two?
We're doing two.
Two recipes, okay.
Okay.
You've got ahead of us.
And I forgot the sun-dried tomatoes, so this will not have as much pizzazz as it usually does, but the sun-dried tomatoes are very, very tasty in there. And so I thought, oh, well, I'll just dehydrate the tomatoes and have them ready for today, but I got in too late last night, and so we don't have it. But it does taste better with the sun-dried tomatoes.
Have you tried to do that yourself?
Yes, I don't buy sun-dried tomatoes anymore. They're too expensive. All you got to do is put your tomatoes in your dehydrator, slice them up, put them in there, and you've got it.
Have you tried it out in the sun?
I have not tried that. No.
The Kansas you can do it easier, probably. Because it's flat.
I can't tell her how she... I have a friend that made her own stove. I have a picture. I'm not sure if she did it, Larry, but you can talk to Sherry. Sherry actually set up a... She wanted to see if it was going to work, and so she set up a dehydrator. She made it with aluminum foil or something.
Oh, yeah.
It heated up like 250.
I've got something that I will show you.
Okay.
That's something like that. Okay, did we get everything in there?
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
Hopefully.
So, we will pulse it.
Except for the garlic. I didn't see any garlic.
Oh, you can't miss the garlic.
Should we put garlic powder instead?
Oh, yeah, let's do garlic powder. You know, I left that in the cooler, too.
Okay. It saves.
Yeah, you don't have to run again.
I'm already overheating.
Okay. Sorry about that. All right, we'll put a little garlic powder. There we go. All right, now we can pulse it.
I'm starting to
stink. Sorry.
Okay.
Go on, here you go. Another few minutes and I'll be fermenting, I think.
I just want it publicly known what a good husband I have. Did you see how he so lovingly went and got all the items that I forgot? Okay, now with the sun-dried tomatoes, it makes this thicker. So, let me taste to make sure. You want to taste it too? Nope. Okay. You'll trust my judgment? Okay. All right, I'm going to pulse it just a little bit more. We need some chia seeds in here.
Or some flax seeds.
Or some flax seeds. I do have flaxseed meal.
Yeah, the sun-dried tomatoes make this more
much thicker. So we're just going to look at this as like a salsa to go on top of the pizza. Whoops, I just got it everywhere.
Pizza in little squares, taco chips.
It's not so
that's
liquid,
right.
Sister.
It's what?
It's not so liquid, but on the pizza.
Yes, when you have the sun-dried tomatoes, it's thick. It's nice and thick. But I did not find any at Whole Foods, and then I got in too late to dehydrate them. So, it's my fault. But it still tastes lovely. This is going to stay raw, and so is our cheese. Next is our cheese.
So I'll put this in a bowl.
Okay.
Before I get a bowl, we'll put it in there.
What?
Oh,
a little flaxseed. Well, I think it'll make it taste funny. So. You what? Yeah. So now we'll switch to the blender. Now, when I went vegan, one of the hardest things for me was cheese. I was just a cheeseaholic. I literally had cheese for every single meal. And now I'm going to talk about something that you guys don't throw tomatoes at me. But, you know, when you go vegan, a lot of people like to use nutritional yeast flakes. And that's how they get these fabulous cheeses. And I'm going to tell you some stories. You take it home. You do with it what you want.
I'm going to ask you about
yeast. But I will tell you why I don't use nutritional yeast flakes anymore. Everybody will tell you, oh, it will not feed yeast. That's true. It won't feed yeast, but I will tell you what it will do. It will make the environment inside of you perfect for yeast to grow. So yes, it does not feed the yeast, but it makes the environment perfect for it just to go wild. And I will tell you a story about a friend. When we were in Georgia, Andy was he was remodeling and building for a friend, and our friend said, oh, I have vertigo so bad, I can't show up. And so, of course, Andy and I, wherever we go, we always end up talking about health. And, yes. And so this guy was telling us, oh, my vertigo is so bad, I just can't show up, I can't help you, I'm so sorry. And Andy went through quite a few questions, you know, are you doing this, are you doing that? And he was doing everything right. And then this was kind of stumping us, you know, how can we help him? And then we said, do you eat nutritional yeast flakes? Oh, yeah, about 4 tablespoons every night on my popcorn.
Wow.
And we're like, bingo.
There's your problem.
There's the problem. And so we said, hey, will you do a favor for us? can we experiment on you? Because I got to tell you, at our house, you are welcome to come and you can spend as much time at our house. But if you get sick or you have any problem, you are my guinea pig. You are my trap-shirt guinea pig because we're always looking for people to experiment on. And and there's only three of us there. So, but anyway, so with this friend, we said, can you lay off the nutritional yeast flakes? And he says, sure, I'll try it. So that night, he does not eat popcorn with nutritional yeast flakes on it. Guess what? No vertigo the next morning. No vertigo. Now, this was so bad that he couldn't get out of bed. Okay? So we're like, okay, try it again. So he tries it. I don't remember how many days he tried it.
But he's not going back to yeast flakes.
Well, he did try it one time after. So he goes a couple of days. And so we're like, okay, so try the nutritional yeast flakes again. Bam! He cannot get out of bed the next day. He's got the vertigo again. And which was just fascinating to us. So you take that story and you do what you want with it. But in our household, you will not find nutritional yeast flakes. And I'm trying to figure if I want to tell the story or not. No.
To add for the cheese sauce?
Yes.
Brother Mike makes cashew pimento macaroni.
Uh-huh.
He puts carrots in it.
Ah.
I boil them. It's easier to blend.
Well, you know what I do? Would you get one tomato? Yes. What I do with my cheese sauces, instead of nutritional yeast flakes, I leave them out and bump up the onion powder. And you will taste this cheese. It will have a nice smoky taste. It will taste very delightful. And I don't miss the nutritional yeast at all in it. Not at all. Yeah. Yes.
Going back to the nutritional yeast for a second, I've heard and I looked on the internet and they said a lot of the nutritional yeast is grown on beets,
sugar. Oh, which would be GMO. Yes, yes, yes. All right. Yes, yes. But like I said, you take the information and you do what you want with it. But I just wanted to say why we don't. Okay. So can we have... So we're going to use cashews, which we soaked them.
For a few hours.
You can do it for a few hours. Usually all of my nuts, grains... Let's see. Nuts, grains, seed, and legumes... They all have enzyme inhibitors around them, mm-hmm. and God made it that way so that they can fall to the ground, they can make it through winter, and they have that little protective coating around them, and then the snow melts, it gets rid of the enzyme inhibitor, and then they can grow a plant. So we want to get that enzyme inhibitor off of them so that we can digest them, because that enzyme inhibitor will make it harder for us to digest. So. All right, so we just put the onion powder in.
Just put the lemon juice?
I mean, the garlic powder. Can you put the... Yeah, you want to do the lemon? And where's my onion powder? Here's my onion powder.
Sandwiches.
I know, but I'm a
standard
low-key cooker.
One. So it's... Okay, so we're doubling it.
Half a lemon?
Yep. So we're doing the whole lemon because we're doubling it. And then one tomato.
There's one in there too.
It's a Vitamix, so probably nobody will ever know.
It's very thick. Yeah, it's very rich. You don't need a lot of it.
Yeah.
Nothing would make it the same thing and change the flavor, like putting in pimentos.
You can.
She doesn't like.
I don't eat pimentos. I don't like peppers.
Something different.
Yeah.
So I think it tastes best with peppers myself. And when I make my cheese sauce, I always put like a pinch of dill weed, because I also don't use yeast flakes, and I find that the dill weed gives it a nice savory flavor that takes the place of the yeast flakes. So,
okay, we're good. Did we get the salt?
No, I didn't put the salt.
You didn't put the salt in? Okay, I'll put the salt in. So we need 3 teaspoons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 65, 66, 67, 68, 69, 70, 71, 72, 73, 74, 75, 76, 77, 78, 79, 80, 81, 82, 83, 84, 85, 86, 87, 88, 89, 90, 91, 92, 93, 94, 95, 96, 97, 98, 100, 101, 102, 103, 104, 105, 106, 107, 108, 109, 110, 111, 112, 113, 114, 115, 116, 117, 118, 119, 120, 121, 122, 123, 124, 125, 126, 127, 128, 129, Usually it's a bacteria issue.
Okay. Well, there's yeast in a lot of, most foods will have some kind of yeast in it. Yeast extracts, all kinds of.
Parasites, yeah.
It will give you vertigo.
Yeah.
But processed foods will usually, it's because it's a flavor enhancer. Go ahead and raise it up.
Okay. Have this lovely cheese. Thank you, ma'am. Can I have a yep, one of those. Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Can you get the pizza?
Now, if you wanted to make like queso or something like that, would you just add salsa to that?
Yes, you could add salsa to that if you wanted to. It would make it real runny. It's not going to stick.
Well, the cashew.
Okay. Well, you may have a very good experience with mixing it. Make smaller pieces and then go back for more. Okay. Oh, you know what? I'm going to put this here.
So I think we're ready to assemble.
Yes. And I'm going to open these up and chop up the olives. Would you get a little bowl for the olives? And I'll go ahead and... Huh? Oh, it's okay. Don't worry about it. That happens all the time. No worries. So, we have some onions here, if somebody wants to put onions on. And I do apologize for the salsa versus the marinara sauce, but you'll still get the idea. And we were going to make a green smoothie, but we've run out of time. So, I apologize for that. But you should enjoy the pizza. I'm a part of the Dutch Oven Club, and so everybody else makes these big pork things and all kinds of meat items at the Dutch Oven meetings, and I make this bread in my Dutch oven and then just get marinara sauce and people can dip it, and I'm getting a really good result from the public with that. So
we're
going to
try the chia pudding first.
Yes, you're going to try the chia pudding and the pizza.
Which, as you can tell, it's become more like a pudding.
Yes, it's nice and thick now. Okay, thank you. This is a hand mixer or an S blade. It's just a little chopper by Pampered Chef. I absolutely love this. I use it all the time. I just wish I had a bigger version of it, like the size of my Cuisinart. But I have not found a solution for that Cuisinart yet. Not the S blade. But this is just very quick and easy, and it chops up olives, as you can see, very, very quickly. Onions, anything like that, you can chop up very quickly. And you don't need electricity. And at our house, we live on an oil field. My husband works in the oil fields, and we get winds that are like 78 miles an hour, and so sometimes power lines go down and that kind of thing. So we can be without power for about a week or so, and these hand items come in handy very, 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 very much. So, all right, let's see, the pizza first. And then this, and we'll get some plates. Some napkins. I'll put the napkins here at the end. And then when you make your plate, make sure you pick up this other raw recipe. It shows how to make corn tostadas. I put tortilla on there. I'm sorry, it should be tostada. And how to make a easy hummus that's made out of black beans. That part is cooked, but see, we're getting our 25% cooked, 75% raw. And you can build a tostada a lot like what we're doing here with the pizza, with different items and a different cashew cheese. And this cashew cheese is really, really good on pasta. If you like macaroni and cheese, you can put it on the pasta of your choice, or you can take what's that green zucchini, and you can make noodles out of it with your little spirulina or with your shredder. You can make it and then you can put that on top and you have a macaroni and cheese. So that will conclude our demo, and now it's tasting time. And, oh yes, please do. I will go ahead and start breaking this up. Uh-huh. We'll break bread together. And I don't know how big a piece you want. There we go. That's probably better. What? Oh, depending on how many people are here. I have no idea how many are here. And a lot of times we'll have sprouts with this.
25.
Okay. Now, and since this did not have yeast in it, you can go ahead and eat it now. Well, I made this one earlier so that, because I thought I had the yeast. But anyway, you know, you do want to wait overnight if you've made a bread with yeast, and then you eat it the next day. So that was the intent with this, but it didn't have yeast in it anyway.
That's good.
So, and that it was solely so Anna Marie could have some. So you're welcome to come up and make a little pizza and see what you think.
Oh, can you think now?
There's little cups if you want to try a little bit of the chia pudding.
Okay.
And a little spoon here.
Yes.
Okay, so we can cut.
You having some, Don? You better
say goodbye to the folks online.
Goodbye. Thanks for joining us. Thank you.